There is a moment, somewhere between the beginning and the end of a thing, when all the stories you've told yourself begin to feel hollow. You hear them enough, these tales of survival, strength, progress, and they harden into facts, until they don't. Commander Elena Vir knew this well. She had heard these stories more times than she could count about human endurance, about the human spirit's ability to persevere in the face of impossible odds. In her line of work, such stories were necessary. They gave soldiers something to cling to when the air grew thick with despair. But Elena had reached the point where the words, no matter how tightly spoken, had lost their substance. She no longer believed them, not in the way she had when she first enlisted, when her heart burned with the conviction that humanity's fight was righteous and necessary. The Varath’ul ships hovered just beyond Earth's orbit, vast machines that shimmered in the cold expanse of space. Their arrival was no surprise. Humanity had been monitoring their movements for months. Yet the reality of their presence, so close, so undeniable, weighed heavy. This was the first time humanity had come face to face with an alien species that not only ignored them, but looked down upon them as a curiosity, a footnote in the greater story of the cosmos. Elena stood before the council in the briefing room, the weight of a planet's future pressing against her chest. Her dark eyes flicked over the holographic projections of the Varath’ul fleet, cold and clinical, like a dissection of some cosmic predator. "They don't see us," she said, her voice steady, each word like a stone placed deliberately. "Not truly. To them, we're an anomaly, nothing more than a product of a hostile world, something to be studied. They don't recognize what we've been through." The council was silent, the men and women seated around the table locked in their own thoughts. They were leaders, politicians, generals, but in that room, they were also just human beings standing on the precipice of something far greater than themselves. "Explain," said General Corrin, his fingers drumming against the polished surface of the table. He was a man of action, not philosophy, but even he sensed the gravity of the moment. "They call Earth a death world," Elena continued. "A planet where life wasn't supposed to thrive. Our gravity, our atmosphere, the very nature of our existence, it's an aberration to them. But they see us and wonder how something could evolve in such conditions. They don't understand that survival here is not just a matter of biology, it's psychological. It's in our bones." For a moment, no one spoke. The council, each one hardened by their own experiences of war, of conflict, knew the truth behind her words. Earth had been a battleground for centuries, not just between nations, but between humanity and its environment. Disease, famine, climate, all working in concert against life. To survive was not enough. To endure was the only option. "Are they here as conquerors, or something worse?" asked a voice from the back of the room. It was the president, a man who wore his fatigue behind his eyes, a leader by necessity rather than choice. Elena considered this carefully. "They're here to observe. They don't see us as a threat, or even as equals. They're not interested in conquest because they don't see anything of value. To them, our strength is accidental, the byproduct of a hostile environment." That was the cruelest truth, Elena realized. The Varath’ul didn't come with malice or greed. They came with indifference, a cold, sterile curiosity about a species they couldn't fully comprehend. To them, humans were anomalies, mistakes. They would take notes, watch, and when they were done, they would move on to more interesting worlds. The council shifted uneasily. There was something worse than an enemy you could fight, an enemy that didn't even see you. "We must engage diplomatically," the president said at last. "If we approach them as equals, perhaps we can negotiate some form of recognition. Perhaps they'll leave us in peace." It was the response of a politician, of course. But peace, in the traditional sense, was not what was at stake here. Elena could see that the moment she first laid eyes on the Varath’ul emissaries. They were standing now, in the central docking bay, watching as the massive Varath’ul ship docked at the station. The alien craft was not like anything Elena had ever seen. It seemed to defy the principles of human engineering, floating effortlessly despite its size. It was not sleek or streamlined as human ships were, but jagged, like the skeleton of some long-dead beast, all angles and harsh lines. As the Varath’ul delegation stepped off the ship, Elena felt the tension in the air thicken. These creatures were not human in any recognizable way. They were tall, impossibly so, their elongated limbs moving with an unsettling grace. Their skin was smooth and metallic, reflecting the harsh lights of the docking bay like polished stone. But it was their eyes that unnerved her most, their eyes, cold and expressionless, devoid of any emotion that she could recognize. The Varath’ul leader stepped forward, his gaze sweeping over the gathered human delegation. He spoke in a language that the station's translator quickly rendered into flat, mechanical English. "We come to study," the Varath’ul leader said, his voice a monotonous hum. "You are of interest to us." Elena exchanged a glance with General Corrin, whose expression was unreadable. The Varath’ul leader continued, "You have survived in conditions where life should not have prospered. Your strength is an anomaly, an irregularity. We wish to understand." There was no malice in his words, no threat. But there was also no respect. To them, humanity was nothing more than a curiosity. "You call our planet a death world," Elena said, stepping forward to address the Varath’ul directly. "You think our strength is a product of survival alone." The Varath’ul leader tilted his head, the motion mechanical. "Is it not? Your species has adapted to a hostile environment. You have endured." "Endurance isn't the same as strength," Elena replied, her voice low. "You see what we've become, but not how we got here. We didn't just survive this world. We shaped it. We fought against the very forces that tried to crush us, and we won. Our strength isn't an accident of biology, it's a choice." The Varath’ul leader's cold gaze lingered on her, and for a moment, Elena thought she saw something shift in those metallic eyes, something like understanding, or perhaps curiosity. "You speak as though your species is exceptional," the Varath’ul leader said. "But there are many species that endure harsh conditions. You are not unique in that regard." Elena smiled, but there was no warmth in it. "You think survival is just about enduring hardship, but survival is about more than that. It's about choice. It's about standing on the brink of extinction and deciding, every single time, that we will not fall. We don't endure because we have to. We endure because we choose to." For a moment, there was silence. The Varath’ul leader regarded her, his expression unreadable. Then he spoke again, his voice as cold and detached as ever. "We shall see." As the Varath’ul delegation turned and began to walk back to their ship, Elena stood there, watching them go. She knew this was only the beginning. The Varath’ul might see humanity as an anomaly, but they would soon learn that humans were much more than that. They were more than survivors. They were fighters. They were creators. They were, in the end, something far more dangerous than the Varath’ul could ever understand. But that understanding would come, Elena thought, as the Varath’ul ship began to lift off, its engines humming softly. It would come in time. And when it did, the Varath’ul would be shocked by what they found. Elena stood where she had been moments before, watching the Varath’ul ship retreat into the distant horizon of space. The weight of their indifferent gaze still pressed on her mind. There was something deeply unsettling about their presence, as though they had not truly seen her or any of the other humans, but rather glanced at some natural phenomenon, curious yet detached. She felt a coldness settle into her bones, a familiar sensation she had grown accustomed to in the years of conflict that had marked her life. As the Varath’ul departed, her thoughts churned with questions. What was their next move? Their curiosity, cloaked in indifference, could easily mask something far more dangerous. She knew well enough that underestimating an opponent was the surest path to destruction, and the Varath’ul, for all their arrogance, seemed to have made that mistake with humanity. It could be their undoing or humanity's. General Corrin broke the silence, his gruff voice a sharp contrast to the sterile hum of the docking bay. "You believe they'll come back, don't you?" Elena didn't answer immediately. She weighed her response carefully, feeling the familiar tug of responsibility gnawing at her. She wasn't just speaking for herself. Every word, every decision, now carried the burden of representing all of humanity. It wasn't the first time she had been in this position, but never had the stakes been so high. "They didn't come here for nothing," she said finally. they'll return. But they won't come as conquerors, not yet. They'll test us first. Corin frowned, his dark eyes narrowing. Test us how? They think we're primitive, Elena said. Strong, maybe, but only because our world demanded it. They don't understand that our strength is a choice. They'll try to measure us, challenge us. To them, it's all a curiosity. We're an experiment. They'll want to see what makes us tick. Corin's mouth twisted into a grimace. So they think we're just animal survivors. Elena glanced at him, her face betraying nothing. We are survivors. That's the truth of it. But that doesn't make us animals. She turned her back to the docking bay, her mind already shifting to the tasks ahead. There would be no rest. The Varath’ul had given them a brief reprieve, but their next encounter was inevitable, and humanity needed to be ready. Ready not for battle, perhaps, but for something more complex. Elena felt it in her bones the tests to come wouldn't be fought with guns or fleets. They would be battles of will, of understanding. And that, in some ways, was even more dangerous. The Varath’ul returned the next day. Their ship descended silently, as if the laws of gravity were merely a suggestion to them. No noise, no fanfare, just the seamless arrival of an advanced race looking down on a species they considered beneath them. This time, they brought something different. The contest was announced with a calm, detached efficiency that bordered on arrogance. Through their translators, the Varath’ul declared that they sought to measure humanity's true strength. The terms were vague, a contest of physical endurance, mental fortitude, and something they referred to only as the essence. Elena didn't trust that word. At the heart of it, the Varath’ul wanted proof. Proof that this so-called Deathworld, with its unstable climate and brutal ecosystems, had produced more than a race of survivors. They wanted to see if there was real strength in the human spirit, or if it was just an evolutionary accident, a trick of nature. Elena's first thought was to refuse. But refusal, she knew, was impossible. To reject the challenge would reinforce the Varath’ul's belief in humanity's inferiority. They needed to show them that humans weren't just toughened by circumstance, but shaped by choice. That their strength was more than skin deep. As preparations for the contest began, Elena found herself walking the corridors of the station, lost in thought. The weight of the moment pressed heavily on her shoulders, not just because of the Varath’ul, but because of what it represented for her personally. She had always been strong physically, yes, but also mentally, emotionally, or so she told herself. But there had been moments, countless moments, when she had questioned that strength, moments where the losses she had endured, the scars she bore both inside and out, had made her wonder if her strength was a curse rather than a gift. She paused by one of the observation windows, staring out at the planet below, Earth, Deathworld, the place that had made her what she was. The irony of it wasn't lost on her. For all its dangers, for all the wars and disasters that had shaped her life, Earth was still home. But was it her strength or her prison? She wasn't sure anymore. Behind her, she heard footsteps. Turning, she saw a young officer approach Lieutenant Rafik, one of the brightest minds in the fleet, and one of the few people whose company Elena tolerated. He had the sharpness of someone who hadn't yet been dulled by experience. "They've selected the tests," Rafik said, handing her a tablet with the specifications. Elena scanned the data. Physical endurance, mental challenges, and this. Her finger hovered over the last item on the list. The essence. It wasn't a physical test, nor a test of intellect. It was something else, something far more dangerous. "What do you think it is?" Rafik asked, his voice betraying a trace of nervousness. Elena shook her head slowly. "They want to see what we're made of, not in the literal sense. They want to understand what drives us. What keeps us fighting when logic says we shouldn't. That's what they don't get about us. The Varath’ul don't understand the human spirit." Rafik nodded, but said nothing. He, too, had the same unease. They both knew that this wasn't just a contest of strength. It was a dissection of humanity's soul. The first test took place in the open terrain outside the station, on the fringes of Earth's harsh wilderness. A storm was brewing in the distance, its dark clouds rolling in with ominous speed, a fitting backdrop, Elena thought, for what was about to unfold. The Varath’ul observers hovered nearby, their cold, metallic eyes taking in every detail. The test of physical endurance was brutal, but that was expected. The Varath’ul pushed the human participants to their limits, forcing them to trek through the storm, to climb jagged cliffs, to face Earth's own unpredictable ferocity. Elena participated alongside her team, her body aching with every step, but her mind focused. She had done this before countless times, in battle, in training. This wasn't new. What was new was the Varath’ul watching them, not with admiration, but with something close to confusion. It was clear they hadn't expected this level of resilience. The humans weren't merely enduring, they were thriving, pushing themselves beyond what the Varath’ul had predicted. There were no moments of hesitation, no signs of weakness. But this was just the beginning. The mental challenge was next. A test of problem-solving, logic, and endurance of a different kind. Elena had expected something more akin to traditional puzzles, but the Varath’ul had other plans. They created situations where the humans had to make impossible decisions, scenarios designed to test not just their intelligence, but their morality, their capacity for sacrifice. In one test, Elena was forced to choose between saving a teammate or completing the mission. She knew it was a simulation, knew that no one would actually die, but the weight of the decision still hung over her like a blade. And then came the final test, the essence. The Varath’ul had set up a chamber, sterile and cold, where each human participant would undergo an individual evaluation. No one knew exactly what to expect, but Elena had a sinking feeling that this was where the real challenge lay. The Varath’ul weren't interested in physical or mental strength. They wanted to see what made humans keep going when all logic, all reason, said they should give up. As Elena stepped into the chamber, she felt the familiar tension knotting in her stomach. This was it. Whatever happened here would determine what the Varath’ul thought of humanity, and she knew deep down that this wasn't just about strength anymore. It was about something far more complex. What would they see when they looked into her essence? What would they find? Elena stood in the sterile chamber, her breath shallow, her mind racing. The stark white walls reflected nothing, a blank canvas where her thoughts seemed to project themselves, exposing her doubts. This was the Varath’ul's final test, one designed to measure more than just her physical endurance or mental acuity. It was about something deeper, something they called the essence. She closed her eyes for a moment, trying to center herself. She wasn't sure what the Varath’ul were looking for, but she knew one thing, it wouldn't be something they could understand. The Varath’ul, for all their technology and sophistication, couldn't grasp the core of humanity. They couldn't see that survival on a death world wasn't just about strength, it was about choice. It was about enduring not because you had to, but because you chose to. As the door behind her sealed shut, the chamber grew impossibly silent. Elena's heartbeat became the only sound, its steady rhythm grounding her in the present. Her body ached from the earlier trials, the storm-laden trek, the steep climbs, and the simulated moral dilemmas that had pushed her to the edge of exhaustion. The test had been brutal, as expected, but they hadn't broken her. Not yet. She waited, knowing that the next challenge would be different. Something about the way the Varath’ul had spoken of this final test made her uneasy. They weren't trying to prove humanity's weakness anymore. They were searching for something else, something they couldn't quantify or understand through logic alone. Suddenly, the lights in the chamber dimmed, and a soft hum filled the air. Elena felt a strange pull at the edges of her consciousness, as if something was reaching into her mind. She tensed, instinctively resisting the sensation, but it wasn't painful. It was searching. For a moment, memories flickered through her mind, flashes of battlefields, of lost comrades, of moments when she had been on the verge of giving up. She saw faces she hadn't thought of in years, heard voices she had long since silenced. The pull grew stronger, and Elena realized with a cold certainty what the Varath’ul were doing. They were looking for her breaking point. Outside the chamber, the Varath’ul watched, their cold, metallic eyes scanning the data streams that flowed from the human test subjects. They had underestimated humanity before, assuming their strength was a product of mere adaptation to a hostile environment. but now they sought to understand the root of that strength, to see what lay beneath the surface. To the Varath’ul, strength was a logical progression, a function of physical superiority and intellectual dominance. But humans were an anomaly. They did not break when expected, nor did they follow predictable patterns of behavior. Their resilience was confounding, their ability to endure suffering incomprehensible. And so, they sought to unravel the mystery of human strength by probing the very essence of what it meant to be human. As they observed Elena, they detected no signs of physical weakness. Her body, though taxed, remained resilient. Her mind, though burdened, was sharp. But this test was not about physical or mental endurance. It was about something more intangible. The Varath’ul leader, a figure known as Commander Axer, spoke in his native tongue, the sounds clicking and humming in a way that was almost mechanical. "We will see what drives them. We will see if their strength is born of necessity, or if it is something more." Inside the chamber, Elena struggled against the pull of the Varath’ul's probing. It was subtle, almost imperceptible, but she could feel it digging into her mind, searching for something. She forced herself to focus, to push back against the intrusion. But even as she resisted, memories continued to surface, memories she had buried long ago. She saw herself as a child, standing in the rubble of her home, the sky dark with ash and smoke. She remembered the sound of her mother's voice, the warmth of her father's hand before the world had crumbled around them. She had survived that day, though she didn't know why. She had survived many days like it since, always pushing forward, always enduring. But was that strength? Or was it simply survival? The memory shifted, and Elena found herself on the battlefield again. The faces of her comrades, the ones who had fallen, blurred into one another. She remembered their names, their stories, the hopes they had once shared. And she remembered the moment each of them had been lost. She had kept going, not because she wanted to, but because she had to, because there was no other choice. And then, as the Varath’ul's pull intensified, a question rose to the surface of her mind, a question she had never allowed herself to ask. Was her strength a gift, or was it a curse? She had always prided herself on her ability to endure, to push through pain and loss without faltering. But now, in the quiet of the chamber, she wondered if that strength had come at too high a price. She had lost so much friends, family, parts of herself she could never get back. Was that strength, or was it simply the result of a life lived in constant struggle? As the question lingered, the Varath’ul's probing stopped. The chamber fell silent once more, the pull receding. Elena opened her eyes, her breath coming in shallow bursts. She felt drained, not physically, but emotionally. The test was over, but the question remained, gnawing at the edges of her consciousness. When Elena emerged from the chamber, she was greeted by the sight of Commander Corrin and Lieutenant Raffic, both of whom had finished their own tests. Their faces were drawn, their expressions heavy with the weight of their experiences. It was clear that the Varath’ul had not gone easy on them. Corrin was the first to speak, his voice rough. "What the hell was that?" Elena shook her head, still trying to piece together her own thoughts. They were looking for something deeper, something beyond physical or mental strength. Raffic, always the more introspective of the three, frowned. "They're trying to understand what makes us human. They want to know why we keep fighting, even when there's nothing left to fight for." Elena glanced at him, her eyes dark with the weight of what she had just experienced. "They won't find the answer they're looking for. Not like this." Corrin snorted. "Good. Let them keep wondering. Maybe they'll realize we're more than just animals." But Elena wasn't so sure. The Varath’ul were relentless in their search for understanding, and she had the sinking feeling that they wouldn't stop until they found what they were looking for. And when they did, it might not be the answer any of them expected. As they made their way back to the station, Elena's thoughts turned inward once more. The question the Varath’ul had stirred within her wouldn't leave her alone. What did it mean to be strong? Was it simply surviving, enduring against all odds? Or was there something more to it, something she had yet to understand? She didn't have the answer yet. But she knew one thing. The Varath’ul weren't done with them. The tests would continue, and humanity would have to prove, once again, that their strength wasn't a product of their environment, but a choice. A choice to fight, to endure, and to survive not because they had to, but because they chose to. High Emissary Varath stood before the massive viewing screen, eyes fixed on the image of Earth spinning slowly in the void. His long, metallic fingers curled behind his back in a gesture of controlled tension. The humans had endured, again. But this time, it wasn't their survival that unsettled him, it was the gnawing sense that something fundamental in his understanding of strength had been shaken. For centuries, the Varath’ul had operated on a singular belief. Superiority was predicated on control, on dominance over nature and other species. Their empire spanned galaxies, their technological prowess unmatched. They saw the universe as a hierarchy, and they perched at the apex. And yet, these humans, these creatures from a planet they had dismissed as a mere curiosity, had withstood the tests. They had not broken. Their strength, unpredictable and chaotic, was unlike anything he had ever encountered. Varath turned from the viewing screen and walked slowly toward his private chamber. As the doors slid shut behind him, the cold, clinical ambience of the Varath’ul ship faded, leaving him alone with his thoughts. He sat in silence, the glow of the control panel casting faint shadows across the sleek metallic surfaces of the room. The humans had resisted the mental probing in ways no species ever had before. Not through sheer mental force, but through something subtler, something Varath couldn't yet grasp. Commander Elena Vir had not only endured the trial, but had emerged from it stronger. Her resolve deepened. Her thoughts, though scattered and heavy with grief, had defied the precision of Varath’ul analysis. How? Far below, on Earth, Elena stood on the deck of the outpost, her eyes scanning the distant horizon where the sun dipped behind the jagged silhouette of mountains. The weight of leadership pressed against her chest like an invisible hand. She hadn't asked for this, hadn't wanted to represent all of humanity in this impossible struggle. And yet, here she was, leading not because she had been chosen, but because no one else had stepped forward. Korn approached from behind, his heavy boots crunching against the gravel as he came to stand beside her. He let out a long sigh, running a hand through his unkempt hair. "So, what's the next move, Commander?" Elena didn't respond at first. Her mind was elsewhere, replaying the Varath’ul's latest test in her head, searching for meaning in the confusion. The probing had unearthed more than just memories, it had stirred something deep within her. Doubts, perhaps? Or maybe questions she had been too afraid to ask before. "We keep going," she said finally, though her voice lacked the certainty she had hoped for. "We don't give them what they want." Korn grunted. "And what exactly do they want?" Elena turned to him, her eyes dark, weary. "They're looking for an answer, but it's not one we can give them." On the Varath’ul ship, High Emissary Varath consulted the ancient archives, seeking understanding in the recorded wisdom of his ancestors. He had studied the rise and fall of countless civilizations, tracing their evolution from primitive beginnings to interstellar empires. In every case, the pattern was the same. Those who mastered their environment, who dominated weaker species, rose to power. Those who failed to exert control fell into obscurity. Yet humanity defied this logic. Their strength wasn't born of control, it was born of struggle. They had fought not just their environment, but each other, their own limitations, and their inner turmoil. Their history was one of constant conflict, and it was that conflict that seemed to define them. Varath wondered if perhaps the Varath’ul's view of strength was too narrow, too rigid. Perhaps their belief in superiority was nothing more than an illusion, a fragile construct that had blinded them to other forms of power. As Varath delved deeper into the archives, he found references to civilizations that had been overlooked by the Varath’ul, species that had lived in harmony with their environments rather than dominating them, species that had thrived not through conquest, but through cooperation. Could it be that there was another way to rise, one that didn't require control? The idea unsettled him. It went against everything he had been taught, everything he believed. But the evidence was there, hidden in the margins of history, waiting to be uncovered. Back on Earth, Elena gathered her team for a briefing. The room was filled with soldiers, engineers, philosophers, each representing a different aspect of humanity's resilience. At the center of the room stood Dr. Isabel Mori, a philosopher whose quiet presence commanded respect. She had been one of the few to grasp the deeper meaning behind the Varath’ul's tests, and Elena had come to rely on her insights. "We're missing something," Elena began, her voice steady but tinged with frustration. "The Varath’ul aren't just testing our strength. They're looking for something else, something they don't understand." Dr. Mori nodded thoughtfully. "The Varath’ul view strength as control over others, over nature. But our strength isn't like theirs. It's adaptive. We grow through conflict, through hardship. But that's not something they can quantify." Elena frowned. "Then how do we show them?"
"You don't," Mori replied calmly. "They have to see it for themselves, and that will only happen when their own assumptions start to crumble."
Elena didn't like the sound of that. Waiting for the Varath’ul to question themselves seemed like a dangerous gamble. But she had no other options. They couldn't win this fight by brute force. The Varath’ul had technological superiority, resources, and a rigid certainty in their worldview. Humanity's only hope was to challenge that certainty not through violence, but through endurance. As the meeting drew to a close, Elena felt the weight of responsibility settle over her once again. She was a soldier, trained to fight. But this wasn't a battle she could win with weapons. It was a battle of ideals, of philosophies, and that terrified her more than any enemy she had ever faced. Varath paced his chamber, his mind racing. He had always been certain of his superiority, certain of the Varath’ul's place in the universe. But now, doubt gnawed at the edges of his thoughts. The humans had shown him something he hadn't expected. That strength wasn't always about control. Sometimes, strength came from enduring what couldn't be controlled. He thought back to Commander Elena Vir, to the way she had withstood the mental probing without breaking. There had been no defiance in her mind, no conscious effort to resist. Instead, she had simply endured, letting the memories and emotions wash over her without being overwhelmed. It was as if her strength came from an acceptance of her own pain, her own vulnerability. Could that be the answer? Could strength lie not in dominance, but in acceptance? The question haunted Varath. He wasn't sure he wanted to know the answer. But he knew one thing: the Varath’ul's view of the universe was incomplete. And that realization unsettled him more than any enemy ever had. As he stared out at the stars, Varath felt the first flicker of something he hadn't experienced in centuries: doubt. And with it came a sense of vulnerability, a crack in the armor of certainty he had worn for so long. Elena stood alone on the outpost deck, her thoughts drifting as the cold wind whipped through the air. She had survived the tests, but she knew this wasn't over. The Varath’ul were watching, waiting, trying to understand what made humanity strong. But what if the answer wasn't something that could be explained? What if their strength was simply the ability to endure, to keep going, even when everything seemed lost? As she gazed out at the distant mountains, Elena realized that the real test wasn't about proving humanity's strength to the Varath’ul. It was about understanding it herself. And that, she knew, would take more than just surviving the trials. It would take confronting the very essence of what it meant to be human. And that was a journey she was only just beginning. Elena stood at the edge of the makeshift command center, staring out across the bleak landscape. The skies were a bruised gray, a permanent twilight that mirrored the growing weight in her chest. She had just finished briefing her team on the latest Varath’ul move in escalation that was rapidly pushing humanity to its breaking point. They had cut off all negotiations and now began to isolate pockets of human resistance across the planet, deploying increasingly brutal measures that forced humanity into impossible choices. In her hand, Elena held a small, worn piece of paper, a letter she had never read. It had been given to her by an old comrade, someone she had trusted with her life, but who had fallen in one of the earlier battles. He had pressed the paper into her palm as his breathing slowed, his eyes wide with the awareness of his final moments. "Read it," he had whispered. That had been months ago, and the letter had remained unopened. She hadn't allowed herself the time or the space to acknowledge his death, or the death of countless others who had fought and died under her command.
Opening that letter meant confronting the cost of the power she now held. Behind her, Corin and Dr. Mori were engaged in a quiet but tense discussion. She could hear snippets of their conversation, but it seemed distant, almost muted against the noise inside her own head. They were talking about strategy, about survival, important things, essential things. But for Elena, the urgency of those tactical decisions was starting to blur, becoming abstract in the face of something deeper, something more personal. High Emissary Varath sat in silence aboard his ship, the hum of the vessel's systems the only sound in the room. Before him was the most recent report. Despite their best efforts, the humans had not crumbled. They adapted, as they always did, their strength refusing to give way to the methods the Varath’ul employed. But something else had changed as well. Varath felt it, like a shift in the air, subtle but undeniable. He leaned back in his chair, his fingers tapping rhythmically against the cold surface of his desk. The question gnawed at him, was it truly power if it required such force to maintain? Could the Varath’ul be the weaker ones, needing to crush anything they didn't understand to keep their place at the top? For the first time in his long life, he felt the burden of his own position, an odd kinship with the humans. They, too, carried a burden, though it was different from his. Their power lay not in domination, but in survival. And yet, survival came with its own price, its own moral weight. Elena paced the room now, the letter crumpled in her fist. She had to focus. There was no time for personal reflection. Not with her people scattered and morale sinking. But the more she tried to push it away, the more the weight of her leadership pressed down on her, suffocating her thoughts. Corin looked up from his conversation with Dr. Mori and caught Elena's eye. He frowned. You all right, Commander? Elena nodded, too quickly. Fine. Just tired. Corin wasn't convinced, but he let it go. We need to decide our next move. The Varath’ul are closing in on the Eastern Quadrant. We can hold out, but if they cut our supply lines... Then we'll adapt, Elena interrupted. Her voice was steady, but her mind was elsewhere. We always adapt. But it wasn't adapting that concerned her now. It was something deeper. She was no longer sure if humanity's strength was enough. Could they continue to bend without breaking? And if they did survive, what kind of world would be left for them? Would there be anything worth saving? Later that night, Elena found herself alone again, the quiet of the outpost unsettling in its stillness. The wind howled outside, a low, mournful sound that seemed to echo her own doubts. She sat down at a small table, the unopened letter before her, and for the first time in months, she let herself think. The burden of power weighed on her in ways she hadn't anticipated. Leadership wasn't just about making decisions, it was about carrying the collective weight of every life affected by those decisions. Every fallen soldier, every civilian caught in the crossfire, every family torn apart by this endless war. It was all on her, and the guilt gnawed at her insides. She picked up the letter, staring at the worn edges. Her comrade, the one who had died in her arms, had trusted her with this. But opening it meant confronting more than just his death. It meant confronting the question that had been haunting her from the start. Was this all worth it? With a deep breath, she unfolded the paper. The handwriting was messy, rushed, as though written in a hurry before battle. Elena, I'm writing this because I need you to know something. You've always been the strong one, the one we all look to when things go to hell. But I've seen what that strength is doing to you. I see the weight you carry, and I'm telling you, you don't have to carry it alone. Power isn't about being strong all the time. It's about knowing when to lean on others, when to trust the people around you. You don't have to save us by yourself. Sometimes, the greatest strength is knowing when to let go. When this is all over, promise me you'll find a way to live. Not survive, life. D. P.S. If you ever tell anyone I wrote something this cheesy, I'll haunt you. Elena laughed softly, but the sound was choked by tears. She hadn't cried since the war began, not once. But now, alone in the dark, with the letter clutched in her hands, she let the tears fall. The next morning, she stood before her team, her expression hard but her voice steady. The Varath’ul think they can break us. But they're wrong. We're not here just to survive, we're here to live. to fight for a future where we don't have to be defined by this war. Corin raised an eyebrow. That sounds suspiciously like optimism, Commander. Elena met his gaze, something quiet but fierce behind her eyes. It's not optimism, it's truth. Back on the Varath’ul ship, Varath continued his solitary reflection. He had always believed that power came from control, from dominance. But now, watching the humans defy everything he had thrown at them, he began to wonder if power might lie in something else. Something he had never considered. He stared at the reports before him, and for the first time, the numbers, the graphs, the charts, all of it felt meaningless. There was a power here, but it wasn't one he understood. Not yet. And as that realization settled over him, the burden of his own power grew heavier. Elena led her team forward, their resolve deepened. The Varath’ul may have pushed them to the brink. But the humans had something their enemies didn't understand, a reason to fight that went beyond survival. They weren't just defending a planet. They were defending the very essence of what it meant to live, to be human. And in that, they found a strength that no amount of force could crush. As the outpost stirred with activity, preparing for the next wave of conflict, Elena felt the weight of her leadership lift, if only for a moment. She wasn't alone. She never had been. And for the first time in a long while, she believed that they might just win not because they were stronger, but because they were more than the sum of their struggles. That was their true power, and that was something even the Varath’ul couldn't take away. The cold gleam of the Varath’ul warship shimmered against the endless black of space. Inside, High Emissary Varath sat motionless in his command chamber, watching the latest reports scroll before his eyes. Data on human resistance, battle outcomes, and survival rates painted a picture of a war spiraling out of control. The humans, those primitives from a death-ridden world, had not only survived the Varath’ul's initial strikes, but seemed to thrive in the chaos. Varath's gaze lingered on the casualty figures, his mind heavy with a sense of something deeper than failure. The Varath’ul had always prided themselves on their precise calculations, their ability to dominate through strategy, technology, and sheer force. But now, facing an enemy that refused to break, those calculations seemed meaningless. The humans did not adhere to the logical principles that governed the Varath’ul approach to war. They didn't crumble in the face of superior might. They adapted, they resisted, and, worst of all, they endured. Behind him, the chamber door slid open with a soft hiss. General Torkin, Varath's most trusted military advisor, stepped in, his posture rigid with unease. High Emissary, Torkin began, his voice low and strained, the Council is growing impatient. They question whether our continued efforts against the humans are prudent. Varath turned, narrowing his eyes at the General. Prudent, he repeated, his tone clipped. Explain. Torkin hesitated, his usually unwavering confidence faltering. There are whispers among the ranks. Some of the Council members believe we may have underestimated these creatures. They fear what we do not understand. Our methods, our strategies, they are failing. The humans are not like the other species we have conquered. They are unpredictable. The word hung in the air, and for a moment, Varath felt a chill run through him. Unpredictable. It was a dangerous concept, one that undermined the entire foundation of the Varath’ul's empire. For centuries, they had dominated through knowledge, through an understanding of their enemies that allowed them to control every outcome. But now, with the humans, control was slipping through their fingers. Fear, Varath said slowly, standing from his seat. Is that what we've been reduced to? Fear of these Deathworlders? Torkin lowered his head. They have defied every expectation, Emissary. And with each defeat, their resolve only seems to grow stronger. Our forces are beginning to question whether we are fighting a war we cannot win. On the surface of Earth, Elena stood on a hill overlooking the battlefield below. The scorched earth was littered with the remnants of the latest skirmish, destroyed vehicles, shattered weapons, and the bodies of those who had fallen. The Varath’ul had pushed hard in this attack, but once again, humanity had pushed back harder. Her thoughts were dark, weighed down by the endless cycle of violence. For months, they had fought with everything they had, and though they were holding their ground, Elena couldn't shake the nagging question that had begun to take root in her mind: at what cost? As she walked among the fallen, her boots crunching against the broken terrain, she saw the faces of the dead, not just her soldiers, but the Varath’ul who had fallen as well. The enemy. The invaders. Yet, as she looked at their lifeless forms, she wondered what separated them from her own people. Wasn't this war just as senseless for them? For the first time since the conflict began, Elena felt the creeping doubt that had been simmering beneath the surface. The humans were surviving, yes, but what were they becoming in the process? Each day, each battle, they grew harder, more ruthless, more willing to do whatever it took to survive. And in that survival, were they losing their humanity? In the depths of the Varath’ul ship, Varath found himself staring out into the vastness of space, his mind racing. The humans had done something no other species had ever managed. They had forced him, and his people, to question their superiority. The Varath’ul had always seen themselves as the pinnacle of evolution, a race destined to rule over the lesser beings of the universe. But now, as the war with the humans dragged on, Varath couldn't ignore the growing doubt within him. The council, too, was beginning to fracture. Some still clung to the belief that the humans would eventually fall, that their resilience was merely a temporary obstacle. But others were starting to see the truth, a truth that Varath had only just begun to grasp himself. The humans were not strong because of their technology or their strategy. They were strong because they refused to give up, no matter how dire the situation. They thrived in chaos, adapted to adversity, and found meaning in survival. But what kind of strength was that? Varath's thoughts churned. Was it the strength of a warrior, or the strength of a creature driven by fear and desperation? The humans had become something the Varath’ul couldn't predict or control, and that terrified them. But for Varath, it also fascinated him. Back on Earth, Elena's crisis deepened. The latest victory had come at a steep price. Many of her best soldiers had fallen, and the survivors were growing more distant, more detached from the people they had once been. Elena herself felt the weight of it, the constant pressure to keep fighting, to keep leading. But with each passing day, she wondered if she was losing a part of herself in the process. She met with Dr. Mori later that evening, the two of them sitting in the quiet of the command center. The doctor had always been a voice of reason for Elena, someone who could cut through the noise and help her see the bigger picture. "Elena," Mori began, her voice soft but firm, "you've been pushing yourself harder than anyone else, but you need to ask yourself, what are we fighting for?" Elena stared at her hands, the calluses and scars that had accumulated over months of conflict. "For survival," she said, though the words felt hollow even as she spoke them. "But survival at what cost?" Mori pressed. "We're losing ourselves, piece by piece. You've seen it in the others, and I see it in you." Elena clenched her fists. "We don't have a choice." "We always have a choice," Mori replied. "The question is, are we making the right one?" Varath stood before the council, his voice calm but his mind in turmoil. The schism within the Varath’ul leadership had grown, with more members now openly questioning the war. Some argued for a full retreat, unwilling to risk further losses against an enemy they didn't understand. Others, still driven by pride, called for escalation, for total annihilation of the humans before their influence could spread. Varath listened to the debates, his own thoughts drifting back to his encounters with the human leaders, especially Elena. He had seen something in her, something he couldn't quite define. It wasn't just strength, it was something more primal, something the Varath’ul had long forgotten. The will to endure, not for the sake of domination, but for the sake of life itself. As the council bickered, Varath spoke, his voice cutting through the noise. "We have underestimated them," he said simply. "The humans are not like us. They are not driven by the same desires for control and order. They fight because they must. And that makes them dangerous." A silence fell over the chamber. Varath's words hung heavy in the air, a truth that none of them wanted to acknowledge. "Are we not also dangerous?" one of the counselors asked, his voice laced with disdain. Varath's gaze was steady. "Perhaps. But the question we must ask ourselves is, are we strong enough to understand that there is more to strength than domination? The chamber fell silent, and for the first time, the Varath’ul began to feel something they had never felt before: doubt. On Earth, Elena stood at the edge of the battlefield, the weight of her decisions pressing down on her. She knew the war was far from over, but something had shifted. The Varath’ul were beginning to fear what they didn't understand. And perhaps, so was she. As the wind whipped across the desolate landscape, Elena's thoughts drifted to the future. What kind of world would they be left with if they won? Would there be anything worth saving? And more importantly, would she recognize herself when it was all over? The burden of power was a heavy one, and it was only growing heavier with each passing day. The world trembled beneath Elena's feet. It was subtle at first, barely noticeable, a low hum resonating from the earth itself. But then the tremor grew. The ground shuddered violently, and the distant skyline began to fracture as waves of destruction rippled across the horizon. Buildings crumbled, entire landscapes shifted, and humanity found itself caught in the grip of a catastrophe they hadn't foreseen. The Varath’ul had pressed harder than anyone imagined. Their technology, cold and precise, had triggered a global disaster that was now threatening to wipe out millions. In a war fought with military might and strategic cunning, no one had expected the battle to reach this point, the earth itself tearing apart beneath them. Inside the war room, Elena stood motionless as the reports flooded in. Her officers were shouting commands, pleas, warnings, but their voices felt distant. Her eyes were fixed on the data, on the rapidly spreading destruction marked in red on the holographic map. Entire cities were being swallowed by the earth. Seas were rising. Lives were being extinguished in numbers too vast to comprehend. And it was all happening under her watch. Elena had known the war was escalating, but this was beyond anything she had anticipated. The Varath’ul had crossed a line, using Earth's own volatile environment as a weapon. Now, the choice lay in her hands: attempt to save as many as possible, knowing that a portion of humanity would be lost, or gamble everything on a counterattack that could lead to total annihilation. Her mind raced, torn between the cold logic of survival and the unbearable weight of the lives she had sworn to protect. Was this how it ended? Not in a glorious stand or a tactical defeat, but in the slow, grinding collapse of the world itself. Outside, the ground continued to quake. Elena could see it in the distance, now the earth splitting, buildings tilting and falling like dominoes. Soldiers, civilians, everyone running, desperate, caught between chaos and the cold inevitability of their fate. Her hands tightened around the edge of the command table, her knuckles white. She could feel the eyes of her team on her, waiting for her orders. They trusted her, believed in her ability to lead them through this storm. But deep inside, Elena felt the doubt that had been growing for months resurface with a vengeance. What was the point of all this strength if it only led to more destruction? Was humanity's resilience just a cruel joke, a cosmic irony in which survival was the prize for enduring endless suffering? The words of Dr. Mori echoed in her mind: we always have a choice. The question is, are we making the right one? But was there a right choice here? The Varath’ul had always underestimated humanity. They saw them as primitives, shaped by their harsh planet, surviving only because of their environment's brutality. But the aliens had never truly understood what it meant to live on a death world, what it meant to endure not just for survival's sake, but for the sake of something deeper. For meaning. For hope. And now, as the planet itself seemed to turn against them, Elena could feel that same misunderstanding creeping into her own thoughts. She had led them this far, had carried the weight of leadership on her shoulders. But had she been too focused on the fight, too focused on survival, to see the bigger picture? The Varath’ul had their own beliefs about strength and dominance, but Elena knew now that there was more to life than just enduring. She had seen the cost of that endurance in her own people, seen the way they had hardened, lost parts of themselves in the endless fight. And now, with the world literally crumbling beneath them, she was forced to confront the ultimate question: what was the point of surviving if it meant losing their humanity? The command center was silent now. All eyes were on her, waiting for the decision. Outside, the earth groaned, and Elena could feel the weight of it pressing down on her chest. "We have two options," Commander Hayes said, his voice calm despite the chaos outside. "We can begin the evacuation of the Northern Hemisphere, focus on saving as many as possible. But we'll lose the southern regions. There's no time to save everyone." "And the second option?" Elena's voice sounded distant to her own ears. "We launch a full-scale counterattack on the Varath’ul ship. Their weapon is generating the seismic activity. If we take it out, we can stop the disaster. But it's a long shot. We could lose everything." Elena closed her eyes, the weight of the choice suffocating. Sacrifice a portion to save the whole, or risk it all to fight back. Either way, lives would be lost. It was a no-win situation. But that was the nature of war, wasn't it? Sacrifices, losses, impossible choices. And now, as the leader of a fractured world, she had to make one. But the deeper question, the one gnawing at her mind, wasn't about tactics or strategy. It was about something more fundamental. What was the worth of a life? Could one justify the loss of thousands if it meant saving millions? Was survival at all costs the only way forward, or was there something to be said for choosing a path that preserved the essence of what it meant to be human, even if it led to ruin? Elena's thoughts drifted to the lives lost in the battles leading up to this moment. Faces of comrades, soldiers, and civilians alike flashed before her eyes. Each one a person with hopes, dreams, fears. Each one now gone, sacrificed in the name of survival. And now, here she stood, poised to make another impossible choice. She turned to Dr. Mori, who stood quietly at the edge of the room. "If we do this, if we lose so many, do we deserve to win?" Mori's eyes met hers, soft but resolute. "Deserve has nothing to do with it, Elena. Sometimes there are no right choices, only the ones we can live with." Elena's breath caught in her throat. Could she live with condemning so many to die? Could she live with the knowledge that she had chosen to save some while letting others perish? She had always been a warrior, a leader who took responsibility for her people. But this decision, this burden, was it too much for even her to carry? Outside, the ground roared again, the sound of the earth itself tearing apart. Elena felt the weight of the decision bearing down on her, pressing her into the cold metal of the command table. She closed her eyes, trying to focus, trying to block out the chaos outside. Her mind raced through the options, through the potential outcomes, through the lives at stake. And then, with a deep breath, she made her choice. "Begin the evacuation," she said, her voice steady despite the turmoil inside her. "We save as many as we can." There was no applause, no relief. Just the quiet acknowledgement of a choice made, a burden shouldered. The officers moved swiftly, barking orders, coordinating the massive effort that would be required to save what remained of the Northern Hemisphere. As Elena watched them go, the enormity of the decision settled over her. She had chosen survival, chosen to save as many as she could. But the cost, the lives that would be lost in the South, was a weight she knew she would carry for the rest of her life. In the silence that followed, Elena turned her gaze back to the map, watching as the red zones continued to spread. This was her world, now a world on the brink, teetering between survival and destruction. And she, for better or worse, was the one leading it. As the earth shook once more, Elena whispered to herself, "What have we become?" The skies burned red as the final assault began. Elena stood at the precipice, watching the horizon ignite with streaks of fire. Human ships, patchwork creations of steel, grit, and desperation raced into the atmosphere, facing the impossible. Above them loomed the Varath’ul fleet, sleek and indifferent, casting shadows over the planet they sought to control. Yet the humans were undeterred. There was no turning back now. The time for survival had passed. This was war. "Commander, the northern evacuations are nearly complete," said Hayes, his voice crackling over the calm. "We've saved as many as we could." Elena nodded, though her chest felt hollow. "We've saved as many as we could." The weight of that reality pressed against her every life lost in the southern hemisphere, a silent scar on her conscience. They had been left behind, sacrifices in a game of cosmic proportions. There had been no other choice, but that didn't ease the burden. She pushed the thought aside for now. Focus was all that mattered in this moment. "Elena," a voice called behind her. Dr. Mori approached, his expression weary but resolute. He hadn't slept in days, nor had anyone on her team. Yet the fire in his eyes remained. "The final defenses are ready, but there's something else you need to see." Elena followed him to the tactical display. He gestured to the map of Earth, now dominated by the spread of destruction. The red zones were still expanding, but something else caught her attention. New activity near the Varath’ul ships. "They're preparing to send ground troops," Mori said. "They've realized we won't break from above. This isn't just about domination anymore. They want to crush us. Completely." Elena stared at the screen, her mind racing. So, they're scared after all. The Varath’ul had believed in their superiority, their cold, calculating logic. But now they face something they hadn't anticipated, humanity's refusal to yield. "They think they can finish this by bringing the fight to the ground," Elena said, her voice cold. "We'll show them just how wrong they are." The battle began with a fury unlike anything Elena had ever seen. Human forces clashed with Varath’ul soldiers in the skies and across broken cities. The Varath’ul were methodical, efficient in their destruction. Their weapons were advanced, their tactics precise. But they lacked something crucial, the fire that burned in the hearts of those who had everything to lose. Elena watched from the command center, directing troops with swift precision. Her mind was a battleground of its own, torn between the ruthless efficiency required to win and the moral conflict gnawing at her soul. She had become the leader they needed, cold, decisive, relentless, but at what cost? Humanity was winning, but it wasn't just through force. The Varath’ul had underestimated the creativity, the cunning that came from living on a death world. Elena saw it in the way her troops fought, using terrain to their advantage, improvising tactics, adapting in ways the Varath’ul couldn't predict. Each human soldier fought not just for survival, but for the future of their species. Every step they took was imbued with the fierce determination to prove that they were more than the sum of their struggles. Yet Elena knew the price of that strength. The deeper they fought, the more she saw the toll it took on her people. The scars of war, both physical and emotional, were etched into their faces. They had survived, yes, but survival had a cost, one they were paying with every step forward. Hours passed like moments. The ground was littered with debris and bodies, both human and alien. Elena felt the weight of the battle pulling at her, but she couldn't stop. She had to keep moving, keep leading, keep winning. This was the final push. Everything they had fought for, everything they had sacrificed, came down to this moment. "Commander," a voice crackled through the calm, breaking her concentration. It was Hayes again. "We've breached their primary ship. Our forces are inside. We can take them down from the core." Elena closed her eyes, the enormity of the moment settling over her. This was it, the turning point. If they could destroy the Varath’ul ship from within, they could end this war. But even as the path to victory lay before her, doubt lingered in the back of her mind. Was this what they had become? A species so driven by the need to survive that they were willing to destroy everything in their path? As she stood there, the sound of distant explosions echoing in the distance, Elena felt the crushing weight of leadership bear down on her. She had transformed, evolved from a reluctant commander into the leader humanity needed. But in doing so, she had lost pieces of herself. She had made choices, impossible choices, that had reshaped her soul. And now, standing at the edge of victory, she wondered if it had been worth it. Was this who they were now? A people forged by war, defined by their ability to endure pain and suffering. The Varath’ul had come to Earth believing in their own superiority, their cold logic and technological mastery. But they had never understood what it truly meant to live on a death world. To be shaped by hardship was to be bound to it. And now, as humanity stood on the brink of victory, the question remained: were they fighting for survival, or had they become something more? Something darker? Elena's thoughts were interrupted by another explosion. This one was closer, too close. She turned toward the viewport and saw the towering figure of a Varath’ul soldier emerging from the smoke, its sleek armor gleaming under the red sky. She reached for her weapon, but But before she could act, the alien spoke. "You fight well," it said, its voice calm, almost respectful. "But do you know why we will win?" Elena raised her weapon, her gaze locked on the towering figure. "Enlighten me." The Varath’ul tilted its head, a strange gesture for a being that claimed to be without emotion. "Because you fight from fear. You fight to survive. We fight because we know we are destined to rule. We are not bound by fear. We are bound by purpose." Elena's grip on her weapon tightened, but she didn't fire. Not yet. There was something in the alien's words that struck her, something that echoed her own doubts. "Your purpose is flawed," Elena said, her voice steady. "You fight to dominate. We fight because we refuse to be dominated." The Varath’ul took a step forward, its massive form casting a shadow over Elena. "And that is why you will fail. Survival is not enough. You must have the will to conquer." Elena's heart pounded in her chest, the weight of the words hanging in the air. She had fought her entire life to protect humanity, to lead them through the darkness. But in this moment, she realized the truth. Survival was not the goal. It never had been. She looked into the cold eyes of the Varath’ul and understood. They were fighting for power, for control. But humanity was fighting for something far more profound, the right to define their own future. Elena raised her weapon, her voice unwavering. "We fight to be free." And with that, she fired. As the battle raged on, the truth of Elena's journey became clear. She had unleashed humanity's greatest strength, not their ability to survive, but their refusal to be bound by fear, by control, by destiny itself. The Varath’ul had feared humanity because they didn't understand what drove them. Now they would see. Humanity wasn't fighting because they were desperate. They were fighting because they chose to. And that was a power even the Varath’ul could not comprehend. The silence after the battle was heavy, almost unnatural. Elena stood on the ruined command deck, her eyes scanning the sky as the Varath’ul ships pulled away, their once menacing forms fading into the dark clouds. It wasn't triumph, she felt, not yet. The retreat seemed wrong. It was too sudden, too calculated. But for now, the immediate threat had passed. A dull throb pulsed in her temples, remnants of exhaustion seeping into her bones. She slumped into a chair, staring at the tactical map that still flickered with red, though the flashing lights signaled less urgency now. The world, it seemed, had taken a breath, one tinged with uncertainty. "They're running," Hayes muttered as he approached. His voice was gravelly, coated in disbelief. "After all that, after they pushed us to the brink, they're just leaving." "They're not running," Elena replied, her voice quieter than she intended. "They're retreating? There's a difference." Hayes frowned, his brow furrowing as he processed her words. The room was filled with the low hum of equipment coming back online, the distant echoes of soldiers calling out to each other in the aftermath of chaos. Elena's mind, however, was far from the noise around her. She replayed the battle in her head, the human forces pushing back against the overwhelming might of the Varath’ul, the raw desperation that had driven them forward. And yet, now that it was over, she couldn't shake the feeling that it had all been too easy. Not easy in the sense of the fight itself, humanity had suffered deeply, but easy in the sense that the Varath’ul had let it happen. Almost as if they were testing humanity, probing for weakness. And now, having found what they were looking for, they were leaving. Elena's hands clenched into fists. She had seen this kind of tactic before, retreating not out of defeat, but to lure an enemy into a false sense of security. It was a move born out of arrogance and calculation, not fear. The Varath’ul hadn't been conquered. They were still watching, waiting. Varath stood on the bridge of his command vessel, watching Earth recede into the distance. Around him, the Varath’ul crew moved with practiced precision, adjusting navigation settings and coordinating the retreat. Yet the usual cold efficiency that defined his people seemed absent. The bridge felt tense, uneasy, as if they, too, could sense that something had shifted in the fabric of their understanding. Varath's mind was a male no. He stopped himself. He would not let his thoughts descend into chaos. He was Varath’ul. His thoughts were supposed to be clear, precise, devoid of the emotional undercurrents that plagued lesser species. Yet in the silence of his own mind, he could not ignore the gnawing doubt that had taken root. The retreat felt like a failure, but more than that, it felt like the end of something he could not yet define. We misunderstood them. The thought was simple, but it carried the weight of realization. For so long, the Varath’ul had judged strength by a singular standard their own. Their rise through the cosmos had been marked by domination, by the ability to subjugate and conquer without question. They had believed that other species, like the humans, would crumble beneath their superior technology, their advanced intellect, their precise order. But they had failed to account for something far more primal, something far more resilient. Humanity didn't fight for conquest. They fought for the right to exist. And in that fight, they had discovered a strength that the Varath’ul had never anticipated. It wasn't raw power or military, might it was something deeper, something born of struggle and survival. Something the Varath’ul could no longer afford to dismiss. Vorath's fingers hovered over the command console, his eyes lingering on the tactical readouts. He thought of Elena, the human commander who had stood defiantly against him, who had embodied everything that made humanity so incomprehensible. Her face haunted him, not because she had bested him in battle, but because she had revealed the fragile nature of his own understanding. "What have we missed?" Vorath wondered. What strength lay beyond the calculations, beyond the tactical superiority they had so long depended upon? His people had retreated, but Vorath knew this was not the end. There was more at play. There had to be. Elena sat alone in her quarters, staring at the darkened screen in front of her. Reports from across the globe streamed in casualty numbers, infrastructure damage, the status of various cities left in ruins by the battle. The numbers blurred together as she scrolled through them, her mind barely registering the scale of the destruction. Victory tasted hollow. The Varath’ul's departure should have felt like relief, but instead, it felt like a cliffhanger, an unfinished sentence hanging in the air. Dr. Mori entered quietly, breaking the silence. He looked worse for wear, his usual calm demeanor fraying at the edges after days without sleep. "They'll be back," he said without preamble. There was no need for niceties anymore. They had gone beyond that. "I know," Elena replied, her voice heavy with weariness. "But why leave in the first place? They could have crushed us if they wanted to. We were hanging by a thread." Mori sat down across from her, his eyes filled with the same questions that had plagued her. Maybe they realized they couldn't win the way they thought they would, or maybe. His voice trailed off as he considered the possibility. "Maybe they've seen something in us they didn't expect." Elena frowned. "Like what?" He shrugged. "Resilience. The capacity to endure. Perhaps they thought we'd fold under the pressure. Maybe they've misjudged what true strength is." Elena's fingers traced the edge of her chair, her mind turning over the idea. "So, they've retreated. To reconsider? To find a way to crush us more completely?" "Or to understand us better," Mori suggested. "They've spent so long thinking they're the apex. Maybe now they're not so sure." The silence that followed was thick with uncertainty. The Varath’ul had retreated, but their presence lingered like a shadow over everything. There was no telling when they would return or what they would bring with them. But one thing was clear: they had left because they feared something they couldn't yet comprehend. Elena exhaled slowly, her mind grappling with the enormity of what lay ahead. Humanity had survived, but for how long? What would be required of them next time? As Vorath's ship slipped further into the reaches of space, he remained at the viewport, watching Earth fade from view. The retreat gnawed at him, but not out of shame. It was something else, a dawning realization that the Varath’ul had miscalculated on a fundamental level. Strength wasn't what they thought it was. And now, with the humans still standing, Vorath wondered if the Varath’ul's own destiny had been altered. Perhaps, for the first time in millennia, they had encountered something that could truly change them. The war had ended, but its scars were only beginning to show. The global map was redrawn not by ink, but by the traces of conflict-ruined cities, fractured alliances, and a world struggling to redefine itself in the wake of the Varath’ul's departure. Elena looked out over the once bustling cityscape, now eerily quiet, a fractured mosaic of resilience and ruin. In the streets below, humanity's old hierarchies were dissolving, giving rise to new factions. Groups formed around competing philosophies, each interpreting the aftermath of the conflict through their own lens of hope and despair. The war had revealed not only the strengths of humanity, but also its deep divisions. Elena moved through the city's remnants, her footsteps echoing off the cold concrete. Her presence here was symbolic. She had been the face of resistance, the voice of defiance. Yet now, as the world grappled with the consequences of their survival, her role felt more uncertain than ever. The leaders of the new factions saw her as a relic of the past, a figurehead whose relevance was fading. In their eyes, she was both the hero and the symbol of a lost era. In a makeshift assembly hall, representatives from various factions gathered, each advocating their vision for the future. Elena sat at the periphery, feeling the weight of the world pressing down upon her. The debates were heated, filled with passionate arguments over how humanity should proceed. Some advocated for rebuilding with a focus on unity and cooperation, while others pushed for retribution and the consolidation of power to ensure security against future threats. One faction leader, a man named Gregory Dre, stood at the podium, his voice carrying a tone of bitter resolve. "We fought to survive," he proclaimed, "but survival should not come at the cost of our dignity. We need to ensure that the Varath’ul's departure doesn't become a footnote in our history. We must strengthen our defenses, expand our reach. We cannot afford to be complacent." Another voice, that of a woman named Alara May, countered with a tone of weary caution. "Survival is not enough if it means becoming what we despised. We must rebuild, yes, but not by sacrificing the very principles that make us human. The conflict has shown us that strength is not just in power, but in the ability to rise from the ashes without losing ourselves." Elena's mind wandered as the debate continued. The voices around her blended into a distant hum. She was lost in thought, reflecting on her own journey from a battle-hardened commander to a leader grappling with existential questions. The victory had come at a steep price. She had lost friends, witnessed horrors, and now, as she looked at the world around her, she wondered if the cost had been too high. In quiet moments of solitude, Elena pondered her place in this new world. The sacrifices she had made, the choices she had been forced to make, had they been worth it? The mantle of leadership had once been a source of pride, but now it felt like a burden she could no longer bear. She questioned whether she could continue to lead without losing her own sense of self. Was she still Elena Vir, or had she become a symbol of something greater and more impersonal? Philosophical debates about leadership and power filled her mind. The nature of leadership was one thing she grappled with intensely. In the midst of survival, where does one draw the line between guiding and controlling? Elena had seen how the pursuit of control could corrupt, how even the noblest intentions could lead to tyranny. The very strength that had allowed humanity to survive was now a potential source of internal conflict. In the private confines of her quarters, Elena stared out the window at the cityscape, the faint lights of reconstruction flickering below. The world was beginning to rebuild itself, but what would emerge from the rubble? Would humanity rise with renewed purpose, or would it simply create new forms of conflict? As she sat in the darkening room, Elena's thoughts turned inward. Her leadership had been defined by her ability to endure, to push forward despite overwhelming odds. But now, with the immediate threat gone, she faced a different challenge, leading without losing the essence of what had made humanity worth saving. Can one lead without becoming a tyrant? The question haunted her. The very qualities that had enabled her to survive, the determination, the will to act decisively, were the same qualities that could lead to oppression if not checked. Leadership in times of peace required a different strength, a balance between guiding and empowering. Elena knew she had to decide soon. The world needed direction, but it also needed hope. The new factions, the shifting philosophies, they all demanded clarity, a vision for the future. But as she looked at the fractured landscape of her world, she realized that the most significant challenge lay not in the external threats, but in the internal struggles that now faced humanity. In a moment of quiet reflection, Elena found herself meditating on the cost of survival. The Varath’ul had tested humanity's strength, and humanity had endured. But at what cost? The echoes of conflict resonated through every decision made, every strategy devised. The question was no longer about defeating an external enemy, but about reconciling with the internal conflicts that the war had revealed. As the night deepened, Elena felt a profound sense of responsibility both for her own choices and for the future of humanity. The journey had transformed her, revealing the fragility and resilience of the human spirit. Now, as she prepared to step into the uncertain future, she resolved to lead with wisdom and compassion, understanding that true strength lay not just in survival, but in the ability to build a future worth living. The world was at a crossroads, and Elena knew that the path ahead would be fraught with challenges. But in that uncertainty, she found a glimmer of hope, a hope that humanity could rise above its past and forge a future defined not by the scars of conflict, but by the strength to overcome them. The world was still reeling from the recent conflict, its scars visible in every crumbling edifice and tentative rebuilding effort. But now, as humanity struggled to piece together its future, the Varath’ul returned not with their previous air of invincibility or threats of destruction, but with a new proposal that left the world in a state of uneasy anticipation. The Varath’ul emissaries arrived, not as conquerors, but as seekers of a higher understanding. The atmosphere was charged with a tense, palpable energy, as if the very fabric of the world was holding its breath. Humanity had braced itself for another onslaught, but instead, the aliens presented an invitation to a forum of existential significance, a final test of philosophy and values, rather than strength. In a grand, yet austere hall, the Varath’ul leader, Varath, awaited Elena. The chamber was minimalist, its design stark and uncompromising, reflecting the Varath’ul's preference for clarity and precision. At its center, a large, round table symbolized the equality of the coming discourse, its surface unmarred by any sign of the earlier hostilities. Elena entered the hall with a mix of wariness and resolve. She had been through countless battles, but this was a different kind of confrontation. The Varath’ul were offering humanity a place at the galactic table, a chance to join their ranks, but only if humanity could demonstrate that its survival was more than mere brute strength. Varath stood as Elena approached, his expression inscrutable. He motioned for her to take a seat opposite him. The two sat facing each other, separated by the expanse of the table, yet bound by the gravity of their impending exchange. The air was thick with the weight of philosophical stakes, each word to be exchanged carrying the potential to reshape not just the present, but the future of both civilizations. Varath began the discourse, his voice calm and deliberate. "We have witnessed your capacity for resilience, your ability to endure against odds that would have crushed lesser beings. But we seek to understand more profoundly. If you wish to join the galactic community, you must demonstrate that humanity's strength transcends the physical and reaches into the realm of the philosophical." Elena met his gaze steadily, her mind racing with the implications. The challenge was not one of survival, but of essence. The Varath’ul were testing not just humanity's right to exist alongside them, but the very nature of what it meant to be human. "What is the nature of this test?" Elena asked, her voice steady despite the turmoil within. Varath's eyes were deep pools of ancient wisdom as he spoke. "You must prove that humanity's strength is not a mere reaction to adversity, but a testament to its understanding of existence. We seek to comprehend whether your kind's tenacity and resilience are expressions of a deeper, more enlightened will, or simply reactions to the harshness of your environment." The conversation shifted to a profound exchange of ideas. Elena and Varath debated the essence of strength and destiny, with each statement carrying the weight of centuries of philosophical thought. Varath spoke of the Varath’ul's own rise to power, their belief in a preordained destiny shaped by their superior capabilities. He questioned whether humanity's survival was merely an anomaly or a sign of something more profound. Elena countered with reflections on humanity's journey through suffering and survival. "Strength is not merely about overcoming physical obstacles," she said. It is about finding meaning and purpose in the face of adversity. Humanity's endurance comes from a place of deep-seated resilience and the capacity to seek purpose beyond mere survival. The dialogue became a dance of philosophical exploration, rich with allusions to fate, destiny, and the human spirit. Elena spoke of humanity's ability to find hope even in despair, its quest for meaning despite the often indifferent universe. Varath, in turn, examined these concepts through the lens of his own people's history, how their strength had been forged in a crucible of necessity, and how it had shaped their understanding of their place in the cosmos. As the debate continued, Elena found herself increasingly absorbed in the philosophical inquiry. The test was not merely a challenge, but an opportunity to articulate humanity's values and vision for the future. She grappled with profound questions about the nature of existence and the purpose of strength, her answers revealing the depth of her introspection and her commitment to leading humanity with both clarity and compassion. The Varath’ul had left the Earth's surface, their ominous presence now replaced by an unsettling calm. Yet, beneath this calm lay a simmering tension. Humanity waited for the next move, its leaders and thinkers bracing themselves for what was to come. The Varath’ul, with their intricate alien philosophies and mysterious ways, had left a mark that could not be ignored. When the emissaries reappeared, it was not with the same air of intimidation or superiority, but with a proposal that felt both intimidating and intriguing. The emissaries carried with them a new kind of challenge, one that went beyond the physical trials of their previous encounters. This time, it was a test of the very essence of humanity's soul, a trial of philosophical depth rather than sheer strength. In the grand, austere hall, Elena took her place at the round table, the room filled with the quiet hum of anticipation. Varath, his expression as inscrutable as ever, prepared to initiate a discussion that would test the very nature of human existence. The table was set not just for dialogue, but for a meeting of minds, a battleground of ideas. Elena looked around the hall, noting the simplicity of its design, which contrasted sharply with the grandeur of the debates that would unfold. The Varath’ul, in their minimalist approach, had stripped away any distractions, focusing solely on the essence of the confrontation. This setting was meant to emphasize the purity of their challenge, a challenge that was not about physical dominance, but about philosophical understanding. Varath began the discourse with a voice that held the weight of countless generations. Humanity has shown remarkable resilience and strength. However, to join our ranks at the galactic table, you must demonstrate that your strength is more than an adaptation to adversity. You must show that it is a reflection of a deeper understanding of existence. Elena took a deep breath, recognizing the gravity of the moment. "What is the nature of this test?" she asked, her voice steady despite the undercurrent of tension. Varath's eyes, cold and calculating, met hers with a depth that seemed to peer into the very core of her being. "The test is not about what you can do, but about what you understand. We seek to know if your endurance and survival are expressions of a higher philosophical understanding. If you wish to transcend your Deathworld nature and stand alongside us, you must show that your strength is not merely reactive, but is rooted in an enlightened understanding of your place in the cosmos." As the debate commenced, Elena found herself plunged into a philosophical inquiry that was as demanding as any physical battle she had faced. Varath questioned the essence of human existence and resilience. He probed the motivations behind humanity's drive to survive and thrive despite the odds. Was it a mere reaction to their harsh environment, or was it a sign of something greater? Elena responded with reflections on humanity's journey. "Strength, for us, is not merely about overcoming challenges. It is about seeking meaning and purpose in our existence. Our resilience comes from our ability to find hope and purpose even when faced with overwhelming adversity. We strive not just to survive, but to understand and to grow." Varath listened intently, his expression inscrutable. He then began to recount the Varath’ul's own history, their rise from primitive beginnings to their current state of dominance. He spoke of how their strength was forged in the crucible of their harsh environment, shaping their understanding of their place in the universe. "The Varath’ul," Varath said, "were once a people who faced constant struggle and hardship. Through this struggle, we developed a sense of destiny, a belief that our strength was a reflection of our inherent superiority. But now, we seek to understand if this belief is flawed. If your strength is merely a reaction to adversity, does it hold any true value? The dialogue between Elena and Varath became a profound exploration of destiny, fate, and the nature of existence. Elena articulated humanity's quest for meaning and purpose, its ability to rise above suffering and to seek understanding beyond mere survival. Varath, in turn, reflected on the Varath’ul's own journey, questioning whether their perception of superiority was a limitation rather than a virtue. The conversation delved deeply into philosophical themes. Elena and Varath discussed the nature of destiny, whether it was preordained or shaped by individual actions and choices. They explored the concept of strength, questioning whether it was merely a matter of physical power or if it could also encompass intellectual and moral dimensions. In their exchanges, Elena and Varath engaged in a dance of ideas, each probing the other's understanding of existence and purpose. Elena spoke of humanity's capacity to find meaning in suffering, to seek out hope in the darkest of times. She argued that true strength was not about overcoming obstacles, but about transcending them, about finding purpose and growth despite adversity. Varath responded with reflections on the Varath’ul's own beliefs. He questioned whether their strength, derived from their ability to dominate and control, had led them to a narrow understanding of existence. He pondered if their superiority had blinded them to the deeper, more nuanced aspects of strength and resilience. As the dialogue continued, Elena found herself grappling with the profound nature of the test. It was not just about proving humanity's worth, but about understanding the very essence of existence. The test challenged her to articulate not just the nature of human strength, but its philosophical underpinnings. The conversation reached a critical point when Varath posed a final question. If your strength is a reflection of your understanding of existence, then how do you reconcile the idea of power with the concept of wisdom? Can you be powerful without being wise? And can you be wise without being powerful? Elena took a moment to ponder this question, her mind racing through the complexities of power and wisdom. True strength, she finally replied, is not just about exerting power. It is about wielding that power with wisdom and compassion. To be powerful without wisdom is to risk becoming a tyrant, while to be wise without power is to risk being impotent. The balance between power and wisdom is crucial, and it is this balance that defines the true nature of strength. As Elena left the hall, she carried with her a profound sense of responsibility. The future of humanity was now intertwined with the future of the Varath’ul, and the path forward would be shaped by their collective understanding of strength, destiny, and the essence of existence. The final test had revealed the depth of both civilizations' philosophical inquiry, and it had paved the way for a new era of mutual understanding and exploration. The Varath’ul had withdrawn, their departure not marked by the usual flare of technological grandeur, but by a quiet, almost solemn, retreat. Humanity stood on the precipice of a new epoch, the echoes of their final philosophical confrontation with Varath still resonating in their minds. The aftermath of their victory was not what they had anticipated. In the days following the test, the atmosphere on Earth was one of uneasy anticipation. The war-torn landscapes had begun to heal, and the human spirit, battered yet unyielding, sought to reclaim a semblance of normalcy. The cities slowly stirred with life, their recovery mirroring the resilience of their people. But amidst the reconstruction, a pervasive sense of existential questioning lingered. Elena Vir found herself standing on the precipice of a new reality. She gazed out over a landscape that had been ravaged by conflict and was now struggling to regain its balance. The world was in flux, and she felt an overwhelming sense of responsibility for guiding it into this uncertain future. The Varath’ul's final challenge had not been merely a test of strength, but a profound exploration of human nature and destiny. The Varath’ul had issued a final revelation, one that shook the very foundations of human understanding. The revelation came not with fanfare, but in a moment of quiet gravity. As the Varath’ul prepared to depart, they gathered the leaders of humanity in a secluded, high-tech chamber that overlooked the scarred yet healing planet. Varath, now visibly aged by the intense philosophical struggle, addressed the gathered leaders. His tone was one of unexpected solemnity. Humanity has passed the test we set before you. Yet, there is a truth that must be revealed. Earth, as you know it, was never meant to survive. Your world was a calculated experiment, a part of a higher cosmic order's design to test whether a civilization, born in such adversity, could transcend its nature. The revelation was met with a stunned silence. Elena, standing amidst the human leaders, felt the weight of Varath’s words press down on her. The idea that Earth's survival was a matter of cosmic testing, rather than intrinsic value, was both bewildering and profoundly unsettling. It cast the struggle for survival in a new, almost nihilistic light. Elena's mind raced as she grappled with the implications. Had humanity's struggle, its resilience, and its evolution been part of a grander scheme, a cosmic experiment? The knowledge that their survival had been a test of worthiness, rather than a natural outcome, was a profound shift in understanding. It implied that their victory was not merely a testament to their strength, but a reflection of a cosmic validation. As the Varath’ul departed, leaving behind an eerie sense of finality, Elena withdrew to a secluded chamber within the command center. The room, bathed in the soft glow of ambient light, was filled with the artifacts and remnants of humanity's recent struggle. Here, amidst the symbols of their resilience and conflict, Elena allowed herself a moment of introspection. She reflected on her own journey, from the initial disbelief and confrontation to her ultimate role as a leader in a grand cosmic play. The burden of leadership had been immense, and the personal sacrifices she had made were profound. Her relationship with her own sense of identity and purpose had been irrevocably altered by the trials she had faced. The cost of strength, she now understood, was not just in the battles fought, but in the personal transformation required to lead and survive. Her thoughts drifted to the individuals she had encountered throughout the ordeal: philosophers who had offered insights, soldiers who had embodied courage, and her own allies who had provided support. Each of them had contributed to a collective strength that was more than physical; it was a testament to the enduring human spirit. Yet, amidst this transformation, she felt a profound sense of personal loss. The cost of leadership had been her own happiness, her sense of self, and the future she had envisioned for herself. Elena's final reflections were deeply philosophical, examining the cyclical nature of strength and survival. The Varath’ul's revelation had placed humanity's journey within a broader cosmic context. The struggle for survival, the quest for meaning, and the eventual evolution of human civilization were all part of a larger cycle that transcended individual experiences. As she gazed out at the recovering world, Elena pondered the nature of destiny and the price of power. The struggle for survival had been intense, but it had also brought forth a deeper understanding of existence. Humanity had evolved, adapted, and demonstrated resilience beyond the expectations of their cosmic observers. Yet, the true cost of this evolution was the loss of innocence and the realization of their role in a grander scheme. Elena, though weary and introspective, found a glimmer of hope in the emerging dawn. The future was now a canvas upon which humanity could paint its own destiny, guided by the lessons learned from their trials and the cosmic revelations that had shaped their journey. The price of strength, though significant, had led to a deeper understanding of their place in the universe and the nature of existence itself. As the first rays of sunlight touched the rejuvenated landscape, Elena embraced the promise of a new beginning. The world had been irrevocably altered, but it was a change that carried the potential for growth, understanding, and a renewed sense of purpose. The cosmic experiment had revealed the true nature of strength and survival, and humanity stood ready to face the future with a newfound wisdom and resilience. Her mind replayed the final moments with Varath. She remembered the slight tremble in his voice as he delivered the truth, as if the weight of his own words shook even him. The Varath’ul had never doubted their superiority, and yet, in the end, it was they who feared humanity. Not for their raw strength, but for something far more unsettling: their unpredictability, their capacity to rise beyond what was expected of them. But now, Elena stood alone with the knowledge that they had been observed, perhaps even manipulated, by forces beyond their comprehension. The test was over, but its shadow lingered, dark and oppressive. Humanity had passed, But was this passage a true victory? Or had they merely followed a path that was preordained, like actors in a play they hadn't realized they were part of? Her thoughts drifted to the Varath’ul. For all their cold logic and rationality, they too had changed. Varath’s eyes had betrayed something different in those final moments, a glint of uncertainty, perhaps even regret. Their mission was not merely one of conquest, but of enlightenment, an attempt to measure the worth of life itself. They had failed in understanding the full depth of human resilience. The Varath’ul had come to dominate, but in the end, it was their assumptions that had crumbled under the weight of human spirit. Their philosophy had been built on the idea of predetermined superiority, that civilizations were destined to rise based on merit, technology, or inherent strength. But what humanity had shown them was something else entirely: an ability to transcend the confines of their harsh environment, not through power or technology, but through a refusal to be defined by suffering. Elena recalled the conversation she had shared with her closest advisors in the final days of the conflict. She had gathered with the brightest minds of Earth, philosophers, scientists, and leaders, to strategize against the Varath’ul's final challenge. But the most profound insights hadn't come from tactics or battle plans. They came from the deep, unspoken understanding that humanity's greatest strength wasn't in its ability to destroy or dominate, but to endure, to persist, no matter the odds. In those final hours, Elena had often sat in silence, listening as others spoke about the future. The unity that had bound them was fragile, like a thread stretched too tight, ready to snap. It was then that she realized leadership was more than making decisions. It was about being the vessel for the collective hopes and fears of an entire species. And now, those hopes and fears were changing. Humanity had endured, but at what cost? The scars of the conflict with the Varath’ul would run deep, not just in the physical landscapes of Earth, but in the hearts of its people. Factions had already begun to emerge, each with their own vision of what the future should look like. Some wanted to embrace the technological advancements left behind by the Varath’ul, to rise and challenge other cosmic powers. Others advocated for a return to simpler times, fearing that humanity's newfound power would only lead to more destruction. Elena felt the weight of this division growing, pressing in on her from all sides. She had been the symbol of unity during the war, but now, in the wake of victory, she wondered if that unity could survive. Could she, as a leader, navigate this fractured landscape? Could anyone? The political meetings that followed the Varath’ul retreat were tense, filled with posturing and ambition. Leaders from every corner of Earth came forward with their vision for the future. There were debates about governance, about the new alliances that should be forged, about how to rebuild. But underlying all these discussions was the subtle acknowledgement that humanity had changed, irrevocably. "We have tasted power," one advisor had said to her during a particularly contentious meeting. "We can never go back. We must forge ahead, claim our place in the stars. The Varath’ul showed us our potential." But it was a sentiment Elena did not entirely share. She had seen the cost of power firsthand, the lives lost, the landscapes destroyed. She had stood at the edge of oblivion and understood that strength came with an unbearable price. Was it truly humanity's destiny to expand, to conquer, to rise as the Varath’ul had done? Or was there another path, one that involved something deeper, something more aligned with the essence of survival itself? She pondered the nature of leadership. For so long, she had believed that leading meant protecting her people, her planet, and her values. But now she questioned whether leadership also meant knowing when to step back, to let go. She had seen too much, lost too much. The battles had scarred her soul in ways she hadn't fully understood until now. Could she continue to lead, knowing that every decision would carry the weight of these revelations? Or was it time to let others take up the mantle? The idea of stepping down had crossed her mind before, but now it felt like a real possibility. Her sense of self, once tied so deeply to her role as commander, had shifted. The human race was at a crossroads, and perhaps new voices were needed to guide them forward. The weight of that thought was both liberating and terrifying. Could she relinquish control, trusting that the future would unfold without her guiding hand? As she walked through the halls of the command center, passing soldiers and scientists who still looked to her for guidance, Elena realized that the end of one battle had merely given way to another, more subtle conflict. The human race was now left with the question of identity. They had passed the Varath’ul's test, but what kind of species would they become? Would they follow the path of their alien adversaries, striving for dominance and control, or would they find a new way, one that embraced their chaotic nature, their ability to survive not through conquest, but through adaptation and understanding? Varath’s final words echoed in her mind. He had spoken of Earth as an experiment, a test of cosmic proportions. But what he hadn't anticipated was that in testing humanity, the Varath’ul had tested themselves. Their own understanding of strength had been challenged, their assumptions dismantled. In the end, it was not the Varath’ul who emerged victorious, but the human capacity for growth, for transcending the limits imposed upon them. The weight of history now rested on Elena's shoulders, but not hers alone. The future of humanity was unwritten, a blank slate waiting to be filled with the choices of a species that had just begun to understand its true potential. The Varath’ul had left, but their presence remained in the questions they had forced humanity to ask of itself. What would it mean to survive, not just physically but spiritually, in a universe where survival had been a test of worth? As the new dawn continued to rise, illuminating the world that had fought so hard to endure, Elena allowed herself a rare moment of hope. Perhaps the future was uncertain, and perhaps the price of strength was high, but there was something beautiful in the fact that humanity had not been shaped by destiny alone. They had shaped themselves, and now, standing at the edge of a new era, they would decide their own fate. Elena took a deep breath, feeling the weight of the past lift ever so slightly from her shoulders. She was no longer bound to the role of commander, nor to the burdens of war. Instead, she was part of something larger, a story of resilience, of survival, of humanity, unleashed into a cosmos that had underestimated them. The future was theirs to create, and in that truth, there was power. Not the power to conquer, but the power to endure, to rise, and to evolve. And as the world turned beneath the light of a new dawn, Elena knew that this was just the beginning. The room was quiet, too quiet. Elena stood at the center, surrounded by Earth's leaders, politicians, philosophers, military commanders, all of whom stared at her with expectant eyes. Outside, the hum of the rebuilt cities echoed in the distance, but here, in the heart of the newly constructed council chamber, the weight of Earth's future hung heavy in the air. On the table before her lay the message from the Varath’ul, a simple but ominous invitation: join us. Take your place among the stars. It was the offer humanity had fought for, survived for. Yet now, standing on the precipice of decision, Elena felt nothing but doubt. The test they had passed had been more than a trial of survival, it had been a revelation of what power truly meant. And now, that power rested in her hands. Her mind raced with the implications. Accepting the invitation meant joining a galactic council, stepping into the cosmic arena alongside species far older and more advanced than humanity. It was a seat at the table, a chance to shape the future of not just Earth, but countless worlds. But at what cost? The factions that had arisen within Earth's ranks over the past weeks were as divided as they were passionate. Some believed this was humanity's destiny to rise as galactic leaders, to carve out their place in the cosmos with the strength they had earned through suffering. Others were more cautious, wary of losing what made them human in the process. Isolationists, in particular, feared that accepting this invitation would strip Earth of its autonomy, binding them to a cosmic hierarchy that might one day subjugate them, just as the Varath’ul had once attempted. And then there were the extremists, those who whispered of humanity's rightful dominance. If they had bested the Varath’ul, what was to stop them from becoming the most powerful force in the galaxy? Elena shuddered at the thought. Power was a dangerous thing once tasted. It had a way of consuming those who wielded it. She closed her eyes, allowing her thoughts to drift back to the war. The battles, the losses, the moments where hope seemed so far out of reach. Humanity had survived not because of their strength alone, but because of their resilience, their ability to endure despite the odds. And yet, in the wake of victory, something had shifted. The very thing that had saved them, this relentless drive to survive, was now pulling them apart. She could feel the tension in the room growing. each faction waiting for her decision, each convinced that their vision of the future was the only one worth following. Elena knew she couldn't delay much longer. The world needed an answer. But what would that answer be? Her thoughts turned to the Varath’ul once more, particularly to Varath. He had been both an adversary and a mirror, reflecting back to her the complexities of leadership and power. In their final confrontation, he had revealed his own doubts about his civilization's path. The Varath’ul had seen strength in domination, in control. But in the end, they had been forced to confront the limits of that philosophy. Power without understanding was a hollow victory, and they had been left to grapple with the consequences of their arrogance. Humanity was now at a similar crossroads. They had the chance to rise, to become something greater than they had ever imagined. But with that rise came the danger of losing themselves. Elena's voice broke the silence. "What does it mean to lead?" she asked, her tone measured, though the weight behind the question was palpable. "Is leadership the ability to dominate, to shape the world in your image? Or is it something else, something deeper?" There was a murmur of agreement from some, confusion from others. She pressed on. "We have been given a choice," she continued, gesturing to the Varath’ul's message. "We can join this galactic council, take our place among the stars. Or we can reject it, remain isolated, protect our autonomy." She paused, letting the words sink in. "But this choice is more than just about us," Elena said, her gaze sweeping across the room. "It's about what kind of species we want to be. Are we destined to become like the Varath’ul, to rise through conquest and control? Or can we find a different path, one that values resilience, endurance, and the strength to grow without losing our soul?" The room was silent again, the tension now replaced by quiet contemplation. The leaders around her shifted uneasily, their earlier certainty wavering. They had all fought for different visions of the future. But in this moment, it was clear that no one's path was without consequence. Elena's thoughts turned inward. She had always believed that survival was humanity's greatest strength. But now, she wondered if it was also their greatest burden. They had endured so much, but in doing so, had they lost sight of what made them human? Could they wield the power they had earned without being consumed by it? "Power is a burden," she said softly, more to herself than to anyone else. "It changes you, and the more you have, the harder it becomes to remember who you were before." Her words lingered in the air, heavy with meaning. She thought of her own journey, the sacrifices she had made along the way. She had started as a protector, driven by a desire to shield humanity from the Varath’ul threat. But now, standing on the other side of that battle, she realized that leadership had cost her more than she had ever anticipated. She had become something else, something harder, more distant. And she wasn't sure if she could ever go back. One of the political leaders, a man named Soren, spoke up. He was a staunch advocate for joining the Galactic Council, and his voice carried the confidence of someone who believed deeply in his cause. "Elena," he began, "we cannot afford to turn our backs on this opportunity. The galaxy is vast, and if we isolate ourselves, we risk falling behind. This is our chance to secure our future, to ensure that humanity is never threatened again." Another leader, a philosopher named Lyra, shook her head in disagreement. "But at what cost?" she countered. "Joining this council might grant us power, but it also ties us to a system we don't fully understand. We could lose our identity, become nothing more than another cog in the cosmic machine." The debate grew louder, voices rising as tensions flared. Elena stood quietly, listening to both sides, her heart heavy with the weight of the decision before her. Each argument held merit, and yet, none of them felt entirely right. There was no easy answer, no clear path forward. But then, a memory stirred within her, the final words Varath had spoken before departing Earth. He had looked at her, his eyes filled with a strange mixture of admiration and regret, and said, "Your strength is not in your power to destroy, but in your will to survive. But remember, survival alone is not enough. To truly live, you must choose how to use that strength." Those words echoed in her mind now, a reminder of the choice before her. Humanity had the strength to survive, but how would they use it? Would they rise as conquerors, shaping the galaxy in their image, or could they find a way to lead without losing themselves? Elena took a deep breath and stepped forward. The room fell silent once more, all eyes on her as she prepared to deliver the decision that would shape the future of humanity. "We have fought for survival," she began, her voice steady. "We have endured the worst the galaxy could throw at us, and we have emerged stronger. But survival alone is not enough. We must decide what kind of species we want to be." She glanced around the room, meeting the eyes of each leader, each faction. "We will join the Galactic Council," she said, and there were murmurs of approval from some, surprise from others. "But not as conquerors. We will not rise through domination or fear. We will take our place among the stars, but we will do so on our terms." She paused, letting the weight of her words settle. The room was tense but attentive, waiting for her to continue. "We will stand for resilience, for endurance, and for the strength to grow without losing our humanity. We will lead not by controlling others, but by showing them that true strength comes from within, from the will to survive, and to choose one's own path." As she spoke, Elena felt a sense of clarity, as if the fog of doubt that had clouded her mind for so long was finally lifting. This was the path forward, not just for her, but for all of humanity. It was not the easy path, nor the most certain, but it was the one that honored everything they had fought for. "We will build a future that is not defined by power, but by purpose," she concluded, "and in doing so, we will remain true to ourselves." The silence that followed was not one of tension, but of understanding. The leaders in the room nodded slowly, accepting her decision, even those who had once opposed it. They had been given a choice, and now, under Elena's guidance, they would walk the path they had chosen. The future was uncertain, but for the first time in a long while, Elena felt a sense of peace. The burden of power was still heavy, but it was one she could carry if not alone, then with the strength of those who stood beside her. The stars stretched endlessly before them, vast, uncharted, and teeming with the unknown. Elena stood at the observation deck of the Persephone, watching as the ship cut through the darkness, its course set for a distant sector of the galaxy. Below her, Earth was fading into the background, a small blue dot swallowed by the enormity of the universe. The weight of leadership, once so familiar, now felt distant, almost abstract. She had stepped away from the role that had defined her for so long, and yet, as she stared into the abyss, she felt something else: relief. Humanity had taken its place among the stars, but not through conquest. The Varath’ul, once a race defined by their arrogance and superiority, had extended an olive branch after their defeat, offering humanity a seat at the Galactic Council. It was a gesture not born from subjugation, but from respect. In their failure to dominate Earth, they had learned a painful truth: strength was not the power to destroy, but the will to endure. The galaxy beyond Earth was vast, filled with ancient civilizations, each with their own histories, their own scars. The Varath’ul were but one of many, and now, humanity was a part of that complex web of politics and power. The Galactic Council was a fragile alliance, teetering on the edge of cooperation and chaos. It was a place where diplomacy often masked deeper conflicts, and where the wrong move could spark interstellar war. But it was also a place where alliances could be forged, where the future could be shaped. Elena had seen enough of power to know its dangers. The thought of guiding humanity through this intricate maze had once appealed to her, but no longer. The battles she had fought had taken their toll, not just on her body, but on her spirit. She had been a soldier, a protector, a leader. Now, it was time for someone else to step forward. The future of humanity was no longer hers to guide. Below her, the new generation of leaders, politicians, diplomats, scientists busied themselves with the details of their mission. Elena watched them in silence, knowing that they would face challenges she could no longer understand. The galaxy was not a battlefield, not in the way she had known. It was a place of ideas, of diplomacy and negotiation. She had spent her life fighting, but this new era required a different kind of strength, one she could not provide. A voice interrupted her thoughts. "You seem lost in thought," said a familiar figure behind her. It was Soren, the diplomat who had once been a fierce advocate for joining the Galactic Council. Now, he was one of the most influential voices guiding Earth's future. He had been chosen to represent humanity in the Council, a role he had embraced with the same passion that had once driven him to argue for humanity's ascension. Elena turned to face him. "Just thinking about how far we've come," she said, her voice quiet. Soren nodded, stepping beside her to look out at the stars. "It's a new world out there," he said, his tone laced with both excitement and caution. "But it's a dangerous one, too. The galaxy is not as united as it appears. We're stepping into a web of alliances and rivalries that have been in place for centuries."
"And you're ready for that?" Elena asked, studying him.
"I don't think anyone's ever truly ready," Soren admitted. "But we've been preparing. We've studied their politics, their histories. We know what we're getting into."
Elena smiled faintly. "I hope you're right."
There was a pause, a shared silence, as they both gazed out at the stars, each lost in their own thoughts. Then, after a moment, Soren spoke again, his tone more thoughtful.
"You could have stayed," he said, glancing at her. "You could have led us through this."
Elena shook her head. "My time is done, Soren. I've fought enough battles. This," she gestured to the stars beyond the glass, "this is not my world. It's yours now." Soren regarded her with a mixture of respect and sadness.
"You did more for humanity than anyone could have asked," he said. "But I understand. There comes a point when the fight has to end."
Elena didn't respond. She didn't need to. The truth was clear enough. Her fight was over, and with it, the weight of leadership had lifted from her shoulders. But even as she stepped away, she couldn't help but wonder what the future held for humanity. They had survived so much, but survival was only the beginning. Could they thrive in this new world, this galaxy filled with danger and intrigue? Or would they fall, as so many civilizations had before them? The galaxy was a place of cycles, after all, rise and fall, strength and weakness, creation and destruction. Humanity had proven themselves resilient, but resilience alone might not be enough in the face of the challenges ahead. As she stood there, contemplating the uncertain future, her mind drifted to the Varath’ul. Their story had changed as well. No longer the invincible overlords they had once imagined themselves to be, they were now humbled, their place in the galaxy questioned. In their defeat, they had learned a valuable lesson, one that would shape them for generations to come. Elena wondered if the Varath’ul would ever truly understand humanity, if they could grasp the complexity of a species that thrived on chaos and contradiction. But then again, perhaps it didn't matter. The Varath’ul, like humanity, were evolving, changing in ways that neither species could have predicted. She thought of Varath, the Varath’ul leader she had once stood against. In their final encounter, there had been no weapons, no battles, only words. Varath had seen in humanity a strength he had never understood, and in that moment, they had reached an uneasy truce. But Elena knew that truce would not last forever. The galaxy was too vast, too complex, for peace to endure indefinitely. Conflict was inevitable. It was the nature of life itself. And yet, as Elena stared out at the stars, she couldn't help but feel a sense of hope. Not the naive hope of a child, but the hard-earned hope of someone who had seen the worst of the universe and survived. Humanity had the strength to endure, but more importantly, they had the strength to change. The ship's intercom crackled to life. "We're approaching the Council station," the voice of the ship's captain announced. "Prepare for docking." Elena took a deep breath, her mind settling as the ship began its slow approach to the massive structure that loomed ahead, a station that housed representatives from every major civilization in the galaxy. This was where humanity's new journey would begin, where their future would be shaped. She turned to leave, her steps measured and deliberate. She was no longer the leader of humanity, but her role was far from over. There were still things to learn, still mysteries to uncover. And perhaps, in this vast galaxy, she would find a new purpose. The station grew larger in the viewport, its intricate architecture a testament to the ancient civilizations that had built it. This was the seat of galactic power, a place where decisions were made that could shape the fate of entire worlds. It was a place of both opportunity and danger, a place where humanity would either rise or fall.
As the docking sequence began, Elena couldn't help but think of the journey that lay ahead, not just for her, but for all of humanity. The road would be long, fraught with challenges they couldn't yet imagine. But for the first time in a long while, she felt a sense of peace. Life, after all, was more than survival. It was about finding purpose, about creating meaning in a universe that often seemed indifferent to both. And perhaps, in this new world beyond death, humanity would finally learn what it meant to live. The doors to the docking bay opened, and with them, the future. The galaxy spread before Elena like a vast tapestry of stars, each point of light a reminder of both the fragility and enormity of existence. She stood on the surface of an unnamed moon, its barren, rocky landscape a stark contrast to the delicate beauty of the cosmos above. The Varath’ul had gone, the council had convened, and humanity had taken its seat at the galactic table. Yet, despite everything they had achieved, Elena felt no triumphant joy. Instead, she felt a quiet, unshakable uncertainty, a gnawing question that refused to leave her mind. Had humanity truly transcended its origins? Or had they merely delayed the inevitable? The air around her was still. The quiet hum of her suit's life support system was the only sound that broke the silence. She found herself thinking of Earth, of the chaos and beauty that had defined her home. The endless wars, the fleeting moments of peace, the resilience of the human spirit in the face of seemingly insurmountable odds. And now, after so much struggle, they had reached a place that few could have ever imagined. They had survived. But survival was not the same as transcendence. Survival was merely the beginning. The question lingered, an unanswered thought suspended in the vastness of space. Could humanity truly change? Or would they always be bound by their Deathworld origins, doomed to repeat the cycles of conflict and destruction that had shaped their history? Elena's thoughts drifted to the past, to the choices she had made and the battles she had fought. Each decision, each sacrifice, had been necessary. But now, standing at the edge of the known universe, she wondered if those choices had truly brought them closer to peace, or if they had simply bought them more time. She had fought to protect humanity, but in doing so, had she simply perpetuated the same patterns of power and violence that had always defined them? There had been no other way, or so she told herself. But now, in this quiet moment of reflection, the doubt crept in. The Varath’ul had forced her to confront the nature of humanity's strength, but even they had not fully understood what it meant to be human. And perhaps, neither did she. Perhaps no one ever truly could. The stars above twinkled with ancient light, each one a reminder of time's unyielding passage. The universe had existed long before humanity, and it would continue to exist long after. Their place in it, no matter how significant it seemed now, was but a brief flicker in the vast ocean of time. And yet, it was that fleeting nature of their existence that made it so precious, so uniquely human. They fought, they struggled, they endured not because they were destined to win, but because they had no other choice. Elena sat down on a low rock, her body heavy with the weight of these thoughts. She remembered Schopenhauer's reflections on suffering, how he had described life as an endless cycle of want and fulfillment, a cruel game in which desire led only to more desire, and suffering was inevitable. Was this, then, the fate of all intelligent life? To be trapped in an eternal cycle of striving, never truly satisfied, always seeking more? She wondered if the Varath’ul had ever experienced such doubts. They had claimed superiority, a belief that their strength gave them the right to dominate. But in the end, it was their inability to understand that strength could take many forms that had led to their downfall. They had seen humanity as a threat because they could not grasp the resilience, the contradictions that defined them. And now, in the aftermath of their departure, humanity was left with the same question. Was strength the power to conquer, or was it the will to endure? And if it was endurance that defined them, what were they enduring for? The council had offered them a seat, a place in the broader galactic order. But that seat came with responsibilities, with expectations. Humanity would be expected to lead, to guide, to shape the future of the galaxy. But how could they do so when they were still struggling to understand themselves? Elena closed her eyes, letting the coolness of the moon's airless surface seep into her bones. She thought of the lives she had touched, the people she had fought alongside, the sacrifices they had made. She thought of Varath, the Varath’ul leader, whose final words had lingered in her mind ever since their confrontation. "You are stronger than you know," he had said, "but strength alone is not enough." At the time, she had dismissed his words as the musings of a defeated enemy. But now, as the weight of her decisions pressed down on her, she understood what he had meant. Strength was a double-edged sword. It could protect, but it could also destroy. It could save, but it could also corrupt. The question was not whether humanity was strong enough to survive. The question was whether they were wise enough to use that strength without losing themselves in the process. In the end, it was a question she could not answer. No one could. It was the eternal question, one that had haunted civilizations for as long as they had existed. And now, it was humanity's turn to face it. Elena stood up, her body feeling lighter despite the gravity of her thoughts. The horizon was beginning to glow with the soft light of a distant star, casting long shadows across the moon's surface. She knew that her time as a leader was over, but that did not mean her journey was complete. There were still mysteries to uncover, still questions to ask, and perhaps, in seeking those answers, she would find a new sense of purpose. As the first rays of light crept across the desolate landscape, she took one last look at the stars. They were a reminder of both the beauty and indifference of the universe, a universe that offered no answers, only possibilities. Humanity had taken its first steps into that vast unknown, and what came next was uncertain. They could rise, or they could fall. They could transcend their origins, or they could be consumed by them. The future was theirs to shape, but it was also theirs to destroy. In the end, there was no clear answer, only the question. As she walked back to the ship, her thoughts returned to Earth, the world that had shaped her, the world she had fought to protect. It was a world defined by contradictions, by beauty and violence, by love and fear. And perhaps that was what made it so uniquely human. They were not perfect, but they were not meant to be. Their strength came not from their ability to conquer, but from their ability to endure, to fight even when the odds were stacked against them. The door to the ship opened with a soft hiss, and Elena stepped inside. The journey ahead was uncertain, but that was the nature of life. It was a journey without guarantees, without clear answers, but that was also what made it worth living. The ship's engines hummed to life, and as it lifted off the moon's surface, Elena allowed herself a moment of quiet reflection. The stars stretched out before them, infinite and unknowable. Somewhere, in that vast expanse, the answers lay waiting. But for now, the question was enough. The universe was full of possibilities, both wondrous and terrifying. And as humanity ventured into the unknown, they carried with them the eternal question: could they rise above their nature, or were they doomed to repeat the cycle of destruction that had defined them? Only time would tell. For now, there was only the journey. And the stars,